أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي قص لنا من آياته عجبا وأفاد توفيقه إرشادا وأدبا وجعل القرآن دافعا عنا مقتا وغضبا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we thank the Almighty Allah for blessing us with another day, for His mercies that He's bestowed upon us. We bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except the Almighty Allah. We also bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is His servant and His messenger. Whosoever the Almighty Allah guides is really guided, and whosoever goes astray doesn't have anybody to blame but themselves. Today is a Saturday, the 23rd day of Ramadan, 1441 years after the Hijrah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It also corresponds with the 16th day of May 2020. There was a question yesterday in my inbox when we spoke about the rights of Muslim women. And the sister was asking that, does Islam allow Muslim women to work. The notion of work is something that we must really, really understand within the context of Islam. Some people feel that if a woman stays home, she doesn't work. I don't believe that. And also, there's this issue of housewife. She is not married to the house. She's not a housewife. That term, I believe, is derogatory to women. Those women who stay at home are not housewives. I call them the homemakers. They make the home. Inasmuch as Islam has allowed a Muslim woman to earn a living, a business, to own property, it must be within... Shaykhana, jazakallah khairan. It must be within the framework of Islamic legal system where it wouldn't open her to unnecessary contacts. It won't affect her reputation and her dignity as a woman. And then it won't affect her role as a mother and a wife. When you look at our mothers or our grandmothers, either they were homemakers or they were entrepreneurs. They sell food. So they had, you know, the free time and then the liberty to take care of their homes, their families, and at the same time take care of their businesses. But then because of the advancement of education, you find out that women are now having careers, as I said the last time. She also leaves home 6 a.m. She comes. So it becomes a problem. She has gone to school, she has studied for a career, and then married, and then there is a conflict between herself and her husband. Does she stay home or does she go to work? And then the work, does the work allow her to be able to, you know, play her role as a wife and as a mother at home? This is the kind of, you know, dilemma some Muslim women or women in general have, you know, in their lives now. Are they mothers and wives at the same time, career women? So that's where the difficulty is. But I believe that the most important job any woman can have is her in the next generation. If a woman is educated, she goes to school, she goes to Makaranta, she attains high level of education, I believe that career, that knowledge, that expertise is better served in her home than serving someone's company. If the woman has, you know, a career that the community needs, maybe she's a teacher, maybe she's a gynecologist, a nurse, a knowledge that the community needs, then I believe that we need to look at the reporting time of women to their offices and the time that they close. If the man and the woman are supposed to report at 6 a.m. in the office and leave at 5 p.m. together, then that woman, her role as a mother and as a wife will be trampled upon. But if we allow our women, if I had my way, women in the offices who are mothers and then wives should report at 10 a.m. and close at 2 p.m. or report at 9 a.m. and close at 2 p.m. She reports at 9 a.m. It means in the morning, she will prepare her children. She will prepare her husband. She will take care of her home because she is the homemaker. After taking care of all these things, the husband leaves for work. The children leave for school. Then she comes in and then prepares to go to the office. She reports at 9 a.m. and then she closes at 2 p.m. When she closes at 2 p.m., by 3 p.m., she is home. The children will normally close from school at 3 p.m. By the time they get home at 4 p.m., she had already rested, and then she had prepared for their coming. Mind you, if children at this tender age don't have the care and attention and closeness of their mothers, it is detrimental in them. And then you know very well that there is a number of hours that children need to have in sleep. If you wake children up at 6 a.m. or at 5 a.m.,
when they are not supposed to be up at that time, it is detrimental to them. So you are rushing the children to wake up at 4 a.m. because you wake up at 4 a.m., prepare for your office, and leave home at 6 a.m. You leave home at 6 a.m., you drop your kids at school at 5:30 a.m. when even the gate man of the school has not yet arrived. And then you are rushing to go to work. When you get to the work, you close at 5 p.m. You are rushing to pass through traffic, get home around 6:30, 7 p.m. Your children have already closed from school around 3 p.m. They are home around 4 p.m. You will be absent. They wouldn't have anybody, or you might bring in mates 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. The kind of trauma or psychological problems that the children might have gone through at school, you are the only therapist to be able to solve that. But then you are also in the office. You close at 6 p.m. You come home at 7, 8 p.m. when the children are preparing to sleep, or they are even sleeping. By the time you come and then prepare and get ready, it's 9 p.m. That's when you are going to sleep. And then you wake up at around 4 a.m. So you do this, and then there is a disconnection between you and your children. So left to me alone, all career women in every jurisdiction in the world, if they are mothers and then their wives, let them report at 9 a.m. and let them close at 2 p.m. That way, they will be able to serve communities, engage in their careers, and at the same time, play their roles as mothers and then as wives. But then, if you open the gates, as we always say, what a man can do, a woman can do, forgoing the roles, forgoing the responsibility, forgoing whatever activities that the women engage in, then we are tying the women down rather than helping them. So I say, let the woman report 9 a.m. and let her close at 3 p.m. That's the best for everybody in the community. She reports at 9 a.m., she closes at 2 p.m. The other thing for me is, I prefer the woman to be in the house. To be in the home. Yes, she can have a career. She can have an entrepreneur. She can be an entrepreneur. But then, her role in the house can never be underestimated. And the reason why I'm saying this is what I have seen personally. My mother is a home. And the kind of effect her staying in the house on me and my other siblings is very, very profound. In the morning, she's there to prepare for breakfast. And then you cannot underestimate the role of breakfast in the life of a child, in the life of a family. And then she sees us off to school, and she took us to school, depending on the proximity of our home and then the school. That is one. Two, when she's home, when we return back from school and then she is in the house, whatever problems we face in the school, just seeing her in the house clears those problems away. And because she is our mother, the moment we are entering the house and then she sees in our face there is a problem, she's able to solve it. Homeworks, education, morals, we received it because the Minister of Interior, the Minister of Defense was always at home. So we didn't have the need for any maids or nannies to take care of us. Any house help we ever had was to help with the chores in the house. That's it. But we didn't have nannies who took care of us. And before her, we were staying with our grandmothers. May Almighty Allah bless their souls. And they were home. For you, they prepare you to go to school. You come back from school, you come and meet them home, and then they nurture you. So it's very, very important we understand that the role that our women play in our homes. My final take on this issue is that I want to just give an advice to our sisters. You are a career woman. You will end up working in some people's companies, you know, nurturing and then taking their companies to the next level for 25 years of your life at least. If you graduate from university at 25, for example, and then you get employment straightforward for 35 years, for 25 years or 30 years of your life, that's the routine. 6 a.m., 6 p.m., 6 a.m., 6 p.m., 6 a.m., 6 p.m. If that goes on, you will have to bring in a nanny to take care of those children. It will continue for 25, 30 years. When you are now laid off or when you go on to pension, you will now want to have a relationship with these children. But then 25 years, you are not around and available for them. And that is going to affect the kind of relationship you have. So what I'm trying to say in a nutshell is that we just have to look at things very well. If we really, really want to empower our women, we really, really want to help them, I believe the best we can do is look at their reporting times, their offices, and then when they close. It's very, very important. A woman should not be prevented from pursuing her career. Yes. But then we need to tailor suit that in a way that will allow her to also be a mother and a wife. And men too, we should try as much as possible to be fathers and husbands within the careers that we have. It's very, very important. We are not seeing that it's only the woman who has the responsibility of bringing up children. No, the man has an equal responsibility in there, because most, you know, reports or researches have shown that unstable families are a result of the absence of fathers in the home. Especially crime, you know, related activities from children happen more in children who are living with single parents, especially with single mothers, because the father figure is also very, very important. But if you lose the father figure, then that's a problem. So some children are in dire situations. They have parents, but then they don't have parents. Their parents are married, but then they don't have joy in that relationship with their parents. So, sisters, I know it's a debate going on social media in the wake of, you know, the comment of the discrimination against women. So it has generated some of these debates that does Islam really allow a woman to work or not? And as we said yesterday in our, you know, message concerning the rights of Muslim women, part 1 and 2, we showed explicitly that the Muslim woman has a right to work, but then it might be the confines of the Sharia. At the same time, it should not, you know, trample or sideline her role as a mother, a wife, and a homemaker. We are discussing the Quran in Ramadan because we said, and then we believe, and then it is a fact that the Quran was revealed in Ramadan. And then it brought us to look at the miracles of the Quran. We talked about the miraculous nature of the message, and then we came to talk about the miraculous nature of the legislation, the Sharia. So we're looking at the Sharia, and then, you know, the characteristics of the Sharia, and then the discrimination against the women entered in, and then we diverted to look at what the Sharia says about, you know, the responsibilities or the rights of the Muslim woman. So we are going to continue with the characteristics of the Sharia to see how compatible is it with modern day times. Because these are some of the, you know, allegations against Islam, that Islam has a legal system that is only fit for 14 centuries ago. It is only fit for, you know, the desert with camels and goats and sheep. But then 21st century, you know, time where we are in a development age, where we are, you know, we are in a time whereby technological advancement and AI and stuff like that, then we don't need the Quran. And then you find some Muslims who have the feeling that there are some aspects of the Quran that must be deleted. Yes, unfortunately, some of them have said so, that there are some aspects of the Quran that must be deleted because it doesn't, you know, work or it's not compatible with present times. You know, very, very sad that sometimes you have some Muslims who have, you know, such an ideology. And it's the reason why, you know, some of these things happen is a lack of clear understanding of the Sharia and lack of studying the Sharia. In the characteristics of the Sharia, we said that the first thing is the Sharia is of divine origin because it's from the Quran and Sunnah, and the Quran and Sunnah are from divine origins. The second thing we looked at was the Quran, the Sunnah, or the Sharia is universal. It belongs to only Muslims, neither does it belong to only Arabs, but it belongs to humanity. The third thing we looked at was at-takamul wa shumul, its complementary and then encompassing nature. That is when we looked at the Sharia discussing, you know, the nitty-gritties of life, business, economics, you know, family life, politics, and stuff like that. Today, we are going to look at at-tawazun wal-i'tidal, which is, you know, moderateness and then the rationality of the Sharia. The Almighty Allah, when He created us from two sources. Surah As-Sad, chapter 71 to 72, the Almighty Allah says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّنْ طِينٍ فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ. Remember when the Almighty Allah told the angels, إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّنْ طِينٍ, I'm going to create a human being from clay. So the first, you know, source of humans is clay. فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. If I have, after I have fashioned him and proportioned him the way I want, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي, and I blow into him my spirit, فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ, fall and prostrate to him. So when you look at this verse is telling us that the Almighty Allah created the human being from two things. The first is clay, and then the second is spirit. So our bodies, or our creation, our originality is of twofold. The first one is the clay part, and then the other part is the spiritual part. So our bodies are made of both spirituality and physicality. And Islam, in understanding that, knowing that very, very well, made provisions for us based on that. So you have spiritual aspect of Islam, and then you have physical aspect of Islam. And Islam has taught us to strike a balance between the two. In Islam, you don't feed the physical aspect detriment of the spiritual aspect. Same way, you don't feed the physical aspect at the detriment of the spiritual aspect. The two are in balance. There is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Maz'un. Uthman ibn Maz'un is a sahabi of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his wife brought a complaint to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Uthman ibn Maz'un is someone who prays at night. He fasts during the day and then he prays at night. He doesn't have time for her. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him and he said, Ya Uthman, inna hadha al-amru laysa rahbaniya. This issue of us, this religion, this Islam, is not something of monasticism at all. It's not something of monasticism. Your wife has a responsibility. Your wife has, you know, a share over you. She has a right over you. So if you fast today, break your fast tomorrow and have issues to do with your wife. The group of Sahaba, we know of that hadith. This group of Sahaba went to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's wives, and then they asked them, how is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his day-to-day activities? The wife said, he fasts a lot, he prays at night, he does this, he does this. These guys, when they came out, they said, wow, this is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them said, from today onwards, I'm going to continue fasting, I'm not going to eat during the day. The other guy said, I'm going to pray at night, I'm never going to stop. The other guy said, me, I'm even going to divorce my wife. If the Prophet Muhammad, then we need to strive harder. So the Prophet Muhammad came out and then he told them, are you the guys who were saying so, so, and so, and so? They said, Nam, Ya Rasulallah. Then he told them, I love women. I pray at night. I have time for my family. I eat. I break my fast. I have intimacy with my wives. From Ar-Raqiba and Sunnati falaysa minni. Anybody who distances himself from my sunnah is not part of me. So the Islamic religion is a religion that considers the spiritual part and then the physical part of your life. Islam doesn't only look at the spiritual part. Islam is not only about sha'air ta'abudiyya. Islam is nation building. Islam is military. Islam is business. Islam is commerce. Islam is every human endeavor that you have at the back of your mind. Islam it is. Islam doesn't relegate the physical aspect of life to the background and then only promote the spiritual aspect. It has at-tawazun wal-i'tidal. It has moderateness and rationality. It doesn't promote one and then leave the other. So as a Muslim, you need to understand this. That it is not about only spiritual aspect, and then science and technology and medicine and nation building, and then we leave all these things in the background, saying that Islam, we only came to the dunya and then we came to worship Allah, and then there's nothing else about that. No, you've got to Surah Al-Jum'ah. This verse explains this concept very, very well. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وذروا البيع. Oh you who believe, if the message or the call is made for the prayer on the day of Friday, فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله. Go, hurry up to the presence of Allah. وذروا البيع. Stop every business transaction. The scholars of Tafsir are saying that the Almighty Allah said, stop every business transaction. It is not only limited to business. Any other activity you stop, and then you move the. This is best for you if you really know. If the prayer is over, spread across the earth, and then seek of the bounties of the Almighty Allah. So if you observe the salah that we have, the Almighty Allah put it at particular points, times, that
my network has started again. So the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, was telling us that فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةِ, if prayer is over, فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, spread across the earth. Spread across the earth. So if you look at salah that we have, the first salah is at dawn. It is a time for you to wake up. Have a relationship. You have a relationship with Almighty Allah at dawn. And then you pray with Almighty Allah. You pray to the Almighty Allah. And then you go out to go and look for your sustenance. There is no other compulsory form of worship in between this time up to Zuhur. You only have optional prayers, and then you only have the laws that you can what? You must follow and not to contravene. But then Zuhur, you go back and then you go and pray. And then if you observe the time for Zuhur, it is when the whole world has silently agreed that it is time for lunch. So in going for lunch, you have the opportunity to go and then pray.
Today, my network is doing to me the same thing it did to me yesterday. It is affecting the flow of the program. It's affecting my flow itself personally. So please bear with me. We are not even yet halfway through the program today. The network is doing this to me. So you look at the form of ibadah that the Almighty Allah has instituted for us on the daily basis, the five salat. You find out that they are at specific times where it allows you to engage in other activities. It allows you to engage in looking for your sustenance, in looking for an education. If you observe, or if you know that the history of Islam is that the prayers were 50 in number. 50. Imagine praying 5 salat in a 50 salat in a day. If it means that even if you're going to pray after every 30 minutes, you're still going to have two deficits. You're going to have 48 because we have 24 hours in a day. If you pray a salah every 30 minutes, you're still going to only pray 48, and then there is going to be two more left. And then you don't even have time for anything. You finish the prayer, you are about to leave the masjid, and then you hear Allahu Akbar, you are back again to the masjid, you pray. You are about to leave the masjid to go and take care of, you know, a family, or visit a sick person, or a sustenance, or something like that. You hear Allahu Akbar, and then you have to come back again. So the Almighty Allah, knowing very well, this is the way He created us. He wanted us to worship Him. And then He put in us these natural dispensations of the need for life, the need for clothing, the need for food, the need for an education. He fashioned the ibadah in such a way that it is not going to take all the time. To understand this, let's go to Surah Taha, verse 6 to 120. The Almighty Allah makes a very profound statement there. He says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ. When the Almighty Allah told the angels to prostrate to Adam, فَسَجَدُوا, they prostrated, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى, except Iblis, who refused. فَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمَ, we told Adam, هَذَا عَدُوٌّ لَكَ وَلِزَوْجِكَ. You see this guy, he is your enemy and then the enemy of your wife. فَلَا يُخْرِجَنَّكُمَا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ فَتَشْقَى. He should not be the cause for you two living out the Jannah, leaving the Jannah, for Tashqa, you Adam are going to suffer. Look at this verse. He said, those of us who understand Arabic, observe the verse. He said, فَلَا يُخْرِجَنَّكُمَا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ فَتَشْقَى. He didn't say, فَلَا يُخْرِجَنَّكُمَا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ فَتَشْقَيَا. He didn't say that. He said, Satan will be the cause, if you're not careful, Adam, Satan will be the cause of you both, you Adam and your wife, leaving Jannah. When you leave Jannah, Adam, you are the one who is going to suffer. The two of you are not going to suffer. Hawa is not going to suffer. You, Adam, you are the one who is going to suffer. So in Islam, Islam never blamed Hawa, Eve, for eating the fruit. They were both blamed equally. And that thank you, brother. May Almighty Allah safeguard us. So, Allah is telling Adam in Surah Taha that Shaitan is your enemy. Make sure that Shaitan doesn't be the reason why you leave Jannah. Because if you leave Jannah, Adam, you are the only one who is going to suffer. So in Islam or in Almighty Allah's program, the woman is not supposed to suffer or be in any problem. That is how Islam has protected the woman. From the beginning, He said, Adam, you and Hawa ate the fruit. But because you, Adam, you are the leader, and then you're not able to protect the family from falling into that sin, if Shaitan succeeds in taking you out of the Jannah through the eating of that fruit, you, Adam, you are the only one who is going to suffer, not Hawa. You're supposed to protect her. And the Almighty Allah told him, Inna laka, you, Adam. Now, The punishment is that both of them will be thrown out of Jannah. But then, the consequences of going out of Jannah is going to be only borne by Adam alone, not Hawa. That is why Islam is of the opinion that the woman's role is in the home, not outside in the sun, scorching sun, struggling with men. No, she is a queen. She needs to be protected. So Allah told him, إِنَّ لَكَ أَلَّا تَجُوعَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى. In Jannah, you are not going to go hungry. And you are not going to go naked. وَأَنَّكَ لَا تَضْمَأُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى. And then you are not going to go thirsty. And then you are not going to go through hardships or throughout the sun. So in this verse, the Almighty Allah points to us four necessities of the human being. One is food. Two is clothing. Three is water. Four is shelter. So the Almighty Allah warned Adam that, Adam,
in Jannah, I have provided all these things for you. So when you come to the dunya, you are going to provide these four things for yourself and then your wife, Hawa. So Islam recognizes the role of business, the role of careers, the role of earning a livelihood. At the same time, it also encourages the what? Ibadah. So if you are able to have a career in Islam, you can metamorphosize your iman or your intention in going to seek a sustenance, and then it will become a form of ibadah for you. So it's very, very important we understand that Islam is not only about staying in the mosque. Islam is not only about going to Hajj. Even if you observe Hajj, Hajj is an opportunity where the Almighty Allah has given the Muslims to meet Muslims from other parts of the world and then discuss issues that are disturbing Muslims, exchange business ideas, exchange political ideas, exchange military ideas, exchange issues about life. But then the problem is that we relegated Islam to only spirituality, and that's it. So the other forms of the Sharia, which has to do with business, which has to do with economics, which has to do with agriculture, which has to do with space travel, which has to do with discovery, which has to do with science and technology, we forget about it. So when it comes to spirituality and morality, we are very, very good. But then when it comes to imarat al-ard, taking care of the dunya, we are weak. That is why if you go to Surah Al-Baqarah, the Almighty Allah says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَائِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. The Almighty Allah told the angels that I want to bring a vicegerent, a manager, a successor onto the surface of the earth. That is the reason why the Almighty Allah created you. You are supposed to be a khalifa, a successor, a manager, a director, a chief executive officer on the earth. That is why the Almighty Allah created you. So when he created you this way, he also told you, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I only created you for you to worship me. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ. I don't need any sustenance from you. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. I don't want them to feed me. So it means that you can look for sustenance, you can look for food within the general framework and context of ibadah. That is why Islam doesn't accept monasticism. That is why Islam abhors you going to find a cave somewhere and then hide in there in the name of ibadah. No, Islam is a communal religion. That is why the Prophet Muhammad said, "Tabassumuka fi waji akhika sadaqa." For you to even meet your brother, your friend, and then you smile in their face is sadaqa. For you to walk from your home to the masjid, you are being rewarded for every step you take. For you to get out of your home, you're going to look for knowledge. The angels spread their wings on the floor for you to step upon. For you to come to the masjid and meet your brother. In Islam, if you meet your brother and then you shake his hands, the moment your hands are in each other's hands, your sins are being forgiven up to the time that your hands are going to part ways. So Islam has given us all these rules. So the moment we only, come to spirituality and then forget about science and technology and putting in place infrastructure, then it becomes a problem. It becomes a big problem. Yes, aqidah, tawheed is normal, but then imarat al-ard is also very, 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 very important. That is why you have the Sahaba being professionals. Abu Bakr Siddiq, astute businessman. Umar ibn Khattab, astute poet and businessman. Uthman, businessman. Ali, a scholar. They were like that. Khalid ibn al-Walid, an army general. Read the history of Khalid ibn al-Walid and realize that up until some few years ago, military academies in the world were using the tactics of Khalid to teach their students military warfare. These guys were doing all these things.
They were managers. Umar ibn Khattab was so innovative in the way he governed that he introduced registers, archives that had the names of everybody in the state. And then he had a system of letter writing, correspondence between him and his managers and then his governors. He was always with them corresponding. The letters were moving up and down. So a Muslim must, during the day, be active, boisterous, have a job, have a career, take care of the community, have a life. At night, he comes and then he prays to his Almighty Allah, uplifting his iman and his spirits. That's what a Muslim is. So if we only sideline one part, if you go to school, school, secular, secular, career, 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 this will be the result of some of the statements that you've heard that are being peddled across. And at the same time, if you only think spiritual, 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 you will not be able to make any meaningful inroads and gains into people's lives. So it's very, very important. We are not saying study Islam and be a sheikh, but no, study Islam in a way that you will be abreast with what Islam is all about. We have millions of examples of Muslim scholars, professionals. At the same time, my own sheikh and mentor, Mala Amin, Sheikh Amin, an engineer with the highways authority, a sheikh who does da'wah. My father didn't know that he was an engineer. So he asked me, Mala Amin, now catch the helmet, the vest. He was amongst those who drew the Kaswa interchange, yes. And even the Dubai interchange, he was there. Even the Malam interchange, he was there too. You see him with his beard, his turban, and then his jalbab. You see him coming, you know this is a sheikh, but he's an engineer too. These are the kind of people we need. You come to Sheikh Hussein, Supol Hussein, Superintendent of Police, Imam Hussein, my father, my uncle, my sheikh, my mentor again, an astute police officer, Superintendent of Police, a sheikh too. The examples are there, plenty. And this is what we need to have as Muslims, every part of the world. If you are a sheikh, that doesn't prevent you from having a career, engaging in business. My elder brother, Councillor Bakri, Muhammad Adam, Abakar of Kumasi, he is into poultry farm business. He's a sheikh. As we speak right now, he's also on Facebook delivering tafsir. But he's also an entrepreneur, a businessman. So until Muslims, we understand the need to fuse these things together, wallahi, we will not make any meaningful role, especially in the country that we are, Ghana. And the Almighty Allah has given us all these tools to be able to succeed. Islam didn't say be only spiritual. Neither did Islam say be only physical. Islam says merge the two. In Surah Al-Qasas, verse 77, we all know the story of Qarun. Inna Qaruna فبغى عليهم وآتيناه من كنوز ما إن مفاتيحه لتنوء بالعصبة أولي القوى إذ قال له قومه لا تفرح إن الله لا يحب الفريحين. Qarun was amongst the people of Musa. The Almighty Allah gave Qarun wealth that the keys to his estates and businesses, he needed people to carry the keys for him. إذ قال له قومه لا تفرح. His people told him, Qarun, arrogant. Inna Allah la yuhibbu al-farihin. Definitely the Almighty Allah doesn't love arrogant people. وَبُتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ دَارَ الْآخِرَةِ. This wealth that the Almighty Allah has given you, this knowledge that Almighty Allah has given you, this connection that Almighty Allah has given you, this life that Almighty Allah has given you, use it to seek for the Akhirah. You are a lawyer, use the law to seek Akhirah. You are a judge, use the judge to seek for the Akhirah. Use the engineering to seek for Akhirah. You are a teacher, use the teaching profession to seek for Akhirah. You are a politician, use it. You are a minister, use it. Use whatever the Almighty Allah has given you as a stepping stone for you to seek for the Akhirah. It is not enough for you to be a professional Muslim and then be ignorant about Islam again. You don't have any excuse. Because you took time and took the pains and then you read books to become a lawyer. You read books to become a judge. You read books to become an engineer. You read books to become... So why can't you have time to read books to understand something basic about Islam concerning, you know, inheritance rights, concerning marital rights in Islam, concerning burial rights in Islam, concerning your Qabli and your Ba'di? You don't have any excuse at all. Because the modus operandi in Islam is Iqra, read. So long as you have been able to read other fields, to be perfect in those fields, to be an authority in that field, then you don't have an excuse. If you make a blatant error in Islam, that is unpardonable. And that is what we are facing now, Muslims. We have Muslim professionals who don't have any respect for the deen. They don't have any knowledge of the deen. We have some Muslims who are spiritual, but then when it comes to dunya, they say, me, dunya, no. Please, don't lie to yourself. The people told him, Karun, use whatever you've received in this dunya to look for the akhirah. Amma, wala tansa nasibaka min ad-dunya. Don't forget your share of this dunya. That is why in Islam, you eat good, you sleep good, you ride a good car, you marry a beautiful person, you enjoy your life so long as you have the means. So during the day, if you have money, build a mansion. If you have money, ride a luxurious car. If you have money, wear good clothes. If you have money, eat good. If you have money, travel across the world. But then, don't forget at night to wake up and pray to the Almighty Allah. Don't forget that the Almighty Allah really has given you that opportunity. It's very, very important. So in Islam, there is this at-tawazun wal-i'tidal. There is this, you know, rationality and moderateness. There is a balance in that, in spirituality and then in the physical things that we have. If you have money, live a good life. If you have money, take care of the good things of the life. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Don't forget your share of this dunya. Riding a luxurious car doesn't mean you don't have iman. Go to Saudi Arabia and see the kind of cars the imams of the haram are riding. And tell me that you don't have iman. Live good. That's Islam. That is why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, part of his sunnah is using perfume and then holding a comb and then having a toothbrush with him. He cleans his teeth. He combs his beard and his hair. And then he has perfume to look nice, to wear good clothes. Don't wear dirty clothes and tell us, the religion of filth. The religion is not the religion of being dirty. When you are dirty and then you let it to iman. No. Iman has nothing to do with you being dirty. Iman has nothing with you to do with you being lazy. Iman has nothing to do with you hiding somewhere and then not fulfilling your potential. Islam has given you that right to fulfill your potential, to pursue a career. Islam has given you that. Islam has given you that right to enjoy life. But then, don't do it at the detriment of Tawheed, Iman, and Ikhlas. That's where the importance is. So don't go and hide in a cave and say, Wallahi, Imani, 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 you are lying. Don't say, hey, me, holy, holy, I won't get married. Iman, you are lying. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you get married, half of your deen has been what? Has been fulfilled. And you say you won't get married because you want to get closer to Allah. And what is this? As for me, I won't get married. I want to get closer to Allah. I won't get married. Master, you are deceiving yourself. The person who gets married and enjoys intimacy with his wife, that is why Islam even teaches us how to be intimate with your spouse. Yes! Islam taught us how to be intimate with our spouses. So don't come and tell me your wife is with you in the room and then she has taken off her clothes and then she's walking sexily in front of you. There is no kunya there. There is no shyness and modesty there. She can choose to remain naked in the room 24 hours. That is even for your own advantage. So don't hide behind your insecurity and then your low level of Islam and then blame Islam for some problems that you are facing. So we need to understand that this is what Islam has made provision for. It supports the physical aspect of life. At the same time, it supports the spiritual aspect of life. Don't hide behind spiritual aspects and then destroy your physical aspect. No. Don't do that. So at Tawazun wal I'tidal that we have in Islam, no religion or no system in this world has it. And these are the two wings that fly Islam. You bath regularly? Yes. Let me tell you, how to even go to toilet, Islam has not left it aside. How to go to toilet, Islam has not left it aside. Even the Jews of Medina were teasing the Muslims. Hey, you Muslims, Muhammad teaches you everything. Even how to go to toilet, he teaches you. Yes. That is why you realize that the early Muslims were so advanced in both Iman and then the dunya because they worked with the two. Go and read about the golden age of Islam. Go and read about the Al-Khawarizmis. Go and read about them. You find scholars, especially the scholars of Andalus, the likes of Imam al-Qurtubi, the likes of Ibn Rushd al-Hafid, they were scholars in fiqh at the same time they were doctors and engineers and astronomers. Go and read the history of Islam in Spain. Come to the history of Islam in Baghdad. At the golden age of Islam, when Europe was wallowing in ignorance, that they even called that time the Dark Ages, Baghdad was a shining light for the world. And Cordoba, at the same time, was also a shining light. Two cities in the world, one in the eastern part of Islam, the one in the western part of Islam, they were shining Europe. And then you come today and then you, I don't know what to call it, your understanding of Islam is something different. Please, don't kill our religion. During the time of Umar ibn Khattab, he was in the market and then he met a man who was walking like this. You know, that kind of, you know, Imani walking. He was walking like that. And Umar asked him, why? Are you sick? He said, no. Then why are you walking like that? He said, Iman, ya Amir al-Mu'min, Iman. Umar slapped his back. He said, hey, raise your chin up. Don't kill our religion. Be boisterous. Be confident. Raise your head up. Go about your activities. And another point. Do you know Umar ibn Khattab appointed a woman as the matron of the market of Medina? A woman. At a time whereby there was Uthman. At a time whereby there was Ali. There was Abdurrahman ibn Auf. These guys were astute business guys. High IQ. High acumen. But then Umar appointed a woman, Shifa binti Abdullah, to be the matron of the market of Medina. It tells you one thing. She had good mathematics, knowledge of mathematics. business skills and she had good administrative skills. And the problem the Muslim Ummah we are facing now, especially in our mosques. This thing that I'm going to say, that is the problem we are facing. Our masajid are the most absent component of our masajid is management. And that is why our masajid are only places where we pray 5 times a day, we tie my and that's it. Nothing again. The masajid, that's it. Especially from where I'm coming from, home. How many masajid do they have administrators? How many? No. Because we have relegated the physical aspect of life to the background and thought that the masjid is only a place for 5 daily prayers. Daure aure, kashi aure, sasuna, yakari. That's all. In other places, it is not like that. Because the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was his office, was the army barracks, was the classroom, was the conference center, was the courtroom, was everything. Everything, the masjid was there. As everything, it was an institution. That is why non-Muslims were able to enter the masjid for treaties, for accepting Islam, for rulings, for. That is what Islam was. That is how the masjid is. So if we really, really, really want to return Islam to its glorious age or time, we should take care of the masjid first and foremost. There's a professor in Nigeria, Professor Lawal, who wrote a book, how do we return the masjid to its original glory? And then he said, every masjid must have 4 committees. Every masjid must have 4 committees. Every masjid must have 4 committees. The first committee is the educational committee. A committee that has been set up to look at the educational needs of the community. Not only tafsir, fiqh, hadith, and seerah, but economics, business, politics, administration too. And then we have the people in the community that can do that. The mosque needs to have an administrator. The problem is that some of us imams feel because by virtue of us being imams, we can run show. It doesn't happen that way. You need to have a knowledge of administration before you run an entity. That is why our masajid or our Islamic institutions are undermanaged and understructured and underorganized. Because I feel by virtue of me being a sheikh, that is the end. I'm the boss, I can dictate terms. So the institution is always dying. I need to go and read administration before I can have that level of what? Knowledge to run that place. Let me give you a clear example. Sheikh Yusuf of Hamdaniya in Newtown. The sheikh went to Lagos to go read administration. That is why Hamdaniya is doing the way she is. So we need to have an administrator. Understand that, sheikh, you are the imam. You might be the overall boss. You might be the final decision-making person. But then hire an administrator to run the mosque. Hire an administrator to run the mosque. It's very, very important. When you have that, educational committee for teaching the community, we have in the community the sheikhs who can teach the tafsir, the hadith, and the seerah. And then within the community, we have the people who can teach adult education to our mothers and our fathers, English and mathematics. We can have people who can teach some level of, business ideologies, something about politics. Sometimes the khutbah that we deliver, we can bring in people who come and talk about what COVID-19 is all about, medical officers. It is not compulsory that the guy who gives the khutbah must be the same person who leads the salah. So we can bring in a lawyer to come and mount the pulpit and tell us our rights and responsibilities and duties as Muslims within the 1992 constitution. After he has finished the khutbah, the imam leads the prayer. The people become enlightened. Because someone like me, even though I've read Islamic law, I cannot mount the pulpit and talk to you about conventional law. We need someone to come and talk to us about the dangers of interest within the banking sector or within the business center. So the mosque must have an educational committee that will take care of that. Number two, the mosque must have an occupational committee, a job-seeking committee for the members of the community. No young man should get up in the community and say, I'm jobless. There must be a committee that takes care of both formal and informal job recruitment. This is what the Christians are doing. And then you complain that they pack the offices with their people. The churches have this ideology, job-seeking committees, that you bring in your certificates and then they look for jobs for you. And then in a month, there is a commission that you donate to the church for them looking for a job for you. We don't do that. We don't do that. We don't look for jobs for our people. Even if they come looking for the jobs, we can't help them because we don't want anybody to be near us. We want to be the only Muslim in that department so that we can do whatever we want to do. And that is the problem we are facing. Job looking committee. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that. He looked for jobs for his companions. A guy came and then he wanted help. He wanted help. Sadaqa. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, what do you have in your house? He said, I have so, so, and so, and so, and so, and so. He said, go and bring them. He brought them a cloth, a bowl. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam auctioned it. He got 2 dinars for that. And then he gave him 1 dinar. The other dinar, he bought an axe for him. Axe. And then he prayed on the axe and then told him, go into the bush and go and collect firewood. I don't want to see you until after a certain number of days. This man went and then he cut wood in the forest. He brought it to the market of Medina. He sold them and he made a promise. And then he developed a business on that. But then sometimes in the communities, the leadership in the masjid do not have that technical acumen of how to look for jobs, even on the internet to go and seek for jobs and then find the job requirements and then the descriptions. So look for that. The third educational committee, occupational committee, and then what? Reconciliation committee. Oh, the third committee. SubhanAllah. Yes. Financial committee. That's the only one we have. That is why I've even forgotten about it. Financial committee. That's the only one we have. And then the financial committee, we don't give it to people who deserve or who are experts. So if the money in the mosque is getting lost, we are complaining. Why should you complain? You have read business, accounting, economics in school. The committee of the mosque called you to make you the chairman of the financial committee. You said you are too busy. They gave it to me, who has 4 wives and 13 children, and I don't have a job. So 1 Ghana cedi, 50 Ghana, 10 Ghana is always getting missing in the money, and then you are coming to complain. Why must you complain? The financial committee must be a committee of astute financial people who are not only interested in fundraising for the masjid, but rather interested also in investing whatever funds that the mosque generates. We have mosque and then we are always adding another floor, adding another floor, adding another floor, always beautifying the mosque. It is good. Why don't we put a maternity on top of the masjid so that my wife and your wife, when it is time for giving birth, you can go there and give birth and then we'll pay as a fee. Why can't the mosque have its down floor as shops and stores that are being what rented, and then on top of that is the masjid where we can pray. On top of it is something. Look at the kind of mosque we have along the streets in Accra. And look at how we are not using them at all. We can build shops in front of this masjid where we lease it out and we get regular monthly incomes from them. And this money will be used to run the masjid, pay school fees as the mosque usually does, take care of orphans, take care of widows, do that. Financial committee. The final committee is the reconciliation committee. Now, anytime there's a problem between Muslims, there's no need for us to fight or take it to the police station to go and disgrace each other. We can have that committee of elderly people who will take care of that? Alhamdulillah, it's been 1 hour, 4 minutes. You have any questions? I think with this, we've ended. We've not even ended characteristics of the Sharia. Hey. Maybe tomorrow, inshallah, we'll look at another characteristics of the Sharia, which is ayyusul waraf al-harj wal-mashaqqa. It's easy, it's simple, it eases affairs. Maybe we'll look at that. We'll look at samahat al-sharia, the forgiveness, forgiving nature of the Sharia, the easygoing nature of the Sharia. Does the Sharia really, really think about chopping off heads and hands? Does the Sharia really, is the Sharia really, really interested in punishing me? So we'll look at that tomorrow, inshallah. It's a very, very important point. Does the Sharia really, really intend to punish people, discriminate against women? But check, who else is to blame back but our imams back home? Honestly, until I came to the United States and with the disposal of women, and I said it. It is not only the imams. Yes, the imams are to be blamed. But it's not only them. It's the community. That's the structure of the community. And that's the problem. Because it's not all the imams that are like that. I've enumerated some imams who have, you know, that progressive nature. Yes. But then it's not the sole responsibility of the imams, or we can blame only the imams. No. It's the community too. It's the community. Our chiefs, our opinion leaders, even us young men, who are there in the masjid, we are all to blame. It is a collective, it's a collective problem. It's not the fault of one individual or one group of people. It is all of us. We are in the soup together. It is true. When you come to the United States, the Bangladesh, the Indian, the Pakistani Muslim communities, you don't find that. They have Islamic centers. It's not about a musalla where you pray alone. No. You have gyms, you have libraries, you have classrooms, you have schools. The masjid has a school, it runs a school. Where I am currently, the Islamic Center of North Detroit has both a school and then a madrasa. And they have apartments that they are renting. The masjid owns apartments that it is renting. They started from a single room and then they ended up buying a church. On a very huge land, and they move from that small room into the church, and that room they are you. Shaykh, be honest, all my life I have never come across one imam that preached secular Islam. Anyway, there's nothing like secular Islam. Islam is Islam, but then within Islam, it has made provisions for, you know, worldly, some doing the world. I really understand that's what you wanted to say, but secular Islam sounds where it is permissible to even invite non-Muslims to the mosque. Yes, it is a cancer that we face, that the non-Muslims cannot come to the masjid. But no, it's wrong. The non-Muslims can come to the masjid. They can come and familiarize themselves with what we are doing. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam invited the Christians of Najran and they stayed with him in his masjid for 3 days. Some narrations even said they had their church service in the masjid. So then Muslims can come to the masjid. The only thing they cannot come to do is when there is a problem. But if they are coming to learn, they're coming to visit, they're coming to show solidarity, why not? Islam's door is open for that. Islam's door is open for that. If you have any questions, Surah Al-Maida, verse 47, I can't say anything unless I see the verse. And if I see the verse, I might have to study the verse if I have not studied it before. Because this is the word of Allah, and then you don't, you know.
وليحكم أهل الإنجيل بما أنزل الله فيه. The people of the book should, what? People of the Bible, they should work with what is in the Bible. ومن لم يحكم بما أنزل الله فأولئك هم الفاسقون. Those who do not work with what the Almighty Allah has revealed, then they are fasiqun. Yes, those who are following Isa alayhi salatu wasalam have to use his book, definitely. But then the problem is that they changed the book. And another issue is that the Quran that has been revealed has come to abrogate all other books. Yes, I understand. I've just read the verse. Yes. But then the issue is the Bible that we have today, is the Injil? Is it the Injil? That's the question. Because if you research on the Red Letter Bible, you understand that the Red Letter Bible from Matthew to Revelation, the words of Jesus in there are in red. That's why it's called the Red Letter Bible. And that it's only 27% of that. That is the word of Jesus in the Red Letter Bible. So the Catholics will not agree with what the Protestants have. The Protestants will not agree with what the Catholics have. The Mormons have their own and stuff like that. So which of the angels are they going to work with? So they themselves have a problem in really, really agreeing as to which of the angel is going to have, is they are going to use. That is where the problem is. But if the right angel was available for them, they should use it. But then also know that the Quran has come to abrogate all these books. But if they don't accept Islam and then they still maintain, the religion, then they must work with what the Bible says. Jesus releases the Gospels. So some of the Gospels are being rejected. The Gospel of Barnabas is being rejected. Is this for Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that is being used? And then you know from Bible studies, from historical events, that these four authors were not disciples of Jesus Christ. They never met him. They never saw him. They never met him. It is just third or fourth witness, third person who is writing there. So this has more to do with Bible study. So you can check videos of Zakir Naik and videos of Sheikh Muhammad Awal of Zaitun Dawah Institute. They will do better justice to these issues of Bible than me. Why is it that in some masjid back home, they always squander the Friday collection, meaning fi sabila among themselves, instead of saving to the masjid? Most of masjid don't have bank accounts. Anyway, is that correct, please? No. The money of the masjid doesn't belong to one or two, three people for them to squander. That's why I'm saying, my uncle, that the problem is that we have not appointed qualified people to run the masjid. That is why this thing is happening. And then the people who are running the masjid, sometimes they don't have jobs. That will aid them. That will help them. Because if you have a job and then you are running the finances of the masjid, you wouldn't need to touch the money of the masjid. And that's the problem. So Islam doesn't see you as that. The issue is, if someone is running the masjid, let's pay them. If we don't pay them, they will put their hands in the coffers of the masjid. That's natural. There's nothing they can do about it. Until we begin to pay imams, until we begin to pay muadhins, until we begin to pay the janitors in the masjid, until we begin to pay the security officer in the masjid, they will dip their hands into the pockets of the masjid. That is why it's important the masjid should have a sound financial committee that will raise funds for the masjid and then invest those funds that will return back in running the masjid. But then if you don't do that, we expect the imam to be there all the time to lead us in prayer, to do this, to do that for us. But then we are not sponsoring the imam. We are not paying him. We are rather enjoying high salaries. And then the imam will have to hold his chin in his hands to think of when to get the next food. And then Afi Sabillah is lying idle. He'll use it on himself. Definitely. So sometimes it is not the fault of our mosque, you know, administrators, the ones who are running the mosque, that the accountability cannot happen the way it must happen, even though it is not something that must happen. But then we, the community, must take care of them so long as we are hiring them as full-time imams.
Sometimes we'll go and then even at Aure, 50 sheikhs, we bring 50 Ghana. Naming ceremony of your child. 5 sheikhs, you give them 100 Ghana. They are going to share 25 Ghana cedi, 25 Ghana cedi each. That is why they will quit Adua. For it to go 2 hours, 3 hours, so that people will bring more. So, and then they get 1,000 Ghana cedi, 4 people, they share 250, 250. But then, if the imam has his office, he is a businessman, or he is a medical officer, he comes and then he just officiates in your marriage 10, 15 minutes. He's gone. He's not waiting for any fees. Really, like he couldn't do it. When the man shita mutu, when the baben shita mutu, when the kakan shita mutu, when the rafani shita mutu, when the keso aure, when the keso dia, when the keso jetuwe, when the kene mantakada, when the kene mekaramata, they won't open any room for all these adua because he has an office to rush back to. If you have any donations you want to do, you donate to the masjid as it is not in the West. But because we are not taking care of the sheikhs, they will put their hands in the coffers. But if the sheikh is well-to-do, he doesn't care about your money at all. Or he's being paid. The masjid pays him. At the end of the month or at the end of the week, he has his allowances. He doesn't even care how much the fees of Allah is. He doesn't want to even know. People like Sheikh Amin, people like Supol Hussein, Sheikh Salman, and stuff like that. You think they have time for the monies? Dr. Hassan, Dr. Hassan, all these people. People like, they are there. Sheikhs who are having their own businesses, who are running their own institutions. They don't care if they come and do wazi, you give them something. You do wazi, you finish. The man, he doesn't have a car to go home. It's now that they are thinking of how to, how much, no, mubash 100 Ghana, no, mubash 200, no, mubash 50 Ghana. Oh no, you are thinking. And the imam, he cannot go because he doesn't have lorry fare to go home. And then he's coming from Kaswa, and then he has come to Ashama to come and do wazi. And then he can't walk. So definitely, he will be doing kulele. That is the state of the conditions of some of the sheikhs that we have in Ghana. That's the situation they are in. So until the community smells the coffee and then wakes up, we cannot blame them for everything. No, we can't. Yes, we can't. When we take care of them and then they mess up, then we can complain. But then when we don't take care of them and then they are doing those things, I'm not supporting that. But then, we don't have the moral right to criticize them for that because we are not taking care of them. But then when we take care of them and then they dip their hands in their pocket, then they are doing evil. Even now that they are putting their hands in the coffers of the masjid, it's not acceptable at all. So if I'm an imam in the masjid and then the masjid is not taking care of me, I'm not going to stay with you. I'm going to look for my job. I'm going to work. If it is time for Salah and I'm in my office, I pray in my office. I pray at my workplace. Find someone to lead the prayer. If you want a constant imam, pay me $5,000 a week. I'll be there. Yes. If you want me to sit in an office, pay me. I'll be there your time imam. I'll report at 8 a.m. and close at after Isha.
Someone is asking one last question, Sheikh. What's the explanation regarding leadership position of the woman in Islam? For example, the position of presidency. Are there Islamic rulings regarding consequences of appointment of a woman on these positions? Please explain. What a woman cannot be in Islam is to be the topmost final decision-making person in the state. But then she can be a minister. Yes. She can be a director. Yes. What Islam is saying concerning the leadership of women is wilayatul amma. Because when Islam appoints a leader, there are responsibilities that he has placed around the neck of the leader. And leadership in Islam has been reserved for males. The topmost leadership has been reserved for males. Because Islam has given some responsibilities upon males. For example, leading the prayer is the duty of the leader. Declaring war and joining the war is the decision of the leader.
And you know Islam's position when it comes to women and being in war. It is not their duty to be in war. So there are some of the responsibilities that Islam has given to a leader. That is the job of a man. The occupational hazard of being a leader. And Islam is protecting the woman from all that occupational hazard. Discriminations, no. The fact that you are leading the prayer doesn't mean your prayer is more acceptable than your wife who is behind you. No. You might be leading the prayer and then your wife who is behind you, her prayer is more rewarding and more acceptable than yours. Leading the prayer is not a sign of you being better in Iman or in the sight of the Almighty Allah. It is just a responsibility that the Almighty Allah has given you. That is one. Two, the reason why men are leading the prayer, some of the scholars are saying, is that, you know, there are times where women are exempted from prayer. So, for example, we are waiting for the imam to come and lead us in prayer and then she's menstruating. And then IEB is also a woman and then she's also menstruating. What then happens to the community? No. So Islam is looking at a lot of issues before a ruling is enacted. Because the ruler or the giver of the rule is the Almighty Allah who created us, who knows us, and who knows what we are all about. So these are not discriminations. If Islam is saying, let me tell you something. All the civilizations in the world that we've known, when she's a president, she's also the chief, commander of the armies. Even though in present day situations, the president does not go to war. He only directs. So some of the scholars are saying, no problem. Since presidency in our time limits some of these, responsibilities that Islam has given to the general ruler, then no problem. She can be a president because she doesn't war, she doesn't lead prayers and stuff like that. It is a political something. Because Islam looks at leadership as both spiritual and physical, spiritual and political. Religious and political. That is why in Islam, there's no separation between the state and religion. Iman and the state in Islam are together. Let me tell you. No, the problem is that we've not nurtured our girls to understand this. That Islam is rather protecting them. All these developed nations in the world have never been foolish enough to send a female-only regiment to war. Do you know of any civilization in the history of the world that said, we are going to war against this nation because of equality and importance of women, we are going to send a female-only regiment to war? Have you ever heard of it? No, because wars are the sole monopoly of men. That is why I've read somewhere that it was written that if women rule the world, there will not be wars. It will only be a bunch of countries who are jealous of each other. So Islam has, responsibilities tied with leadership. And these responsibilities are not privileges. So in Islam, leadership is not a privilege. It is a responsibility. That is why Abu Bakr Siddiq, when he ascended the chieftaincy, he said, وَلِيْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَسْتُ بِخَيْرِكُمْ. I've been made leader over you, not because I'm the best amongst you. It's a responsibility that comes with it. Let me tell you, no matter how much gyming a woman does, no matter how much iron pumping she does, the impact of war is something different. So it's not discrimination against women, it's rather protecting them. There are Muslim women who war during the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, it happened. They engaged in war, but then they were not the fighters. Some of them shot arrows, but then they were not in the thick of thing of it, cutting swords. No. So Islam has, the spiritual responsibility, the religious responsibility, the political responsibility, and some of this responsibility, Islam has relieved the woman of that. Because she has more roles and better roles to play, that is nurturing the next leaders. The woman's role in Islam is nurturing the next leaders, the next generation of leaders.
That is her problem. If she feels Islam says that it has exempted her from that responsibility, if she feels that means she is irresponsible, that is her problem. If she goes to Qiyamah, she can question the Almighty Allah on that. Let me tell you, my brother, don't be interested in satisfying everybody. You can't. Islam, the Sharia, is for the Almighty Allah. And then people are not even satisfied. Some Muslims are not satisfied with the rulings in there. So how much more our explanation? So, it's easy. If I give you the rulings of Islam and then you want to give me your gumshoe and then you your mind, I release myself and leave you alone. That's it. There's nothing you can do about that. Islam has its rules and regulations. If you want to abide by it, abide by it. If you don't want to abide by it, that's your problem. Not everything in Islam must make sense to you at all. Because the level of our level of thinking and understanding varies. Something that you will not be sensible to me. Something that is sensible to me will not be sensible to you. So if you're going to use the mind as the yardstick for measuring rules and regulations in Islam, we will throw a lot of regulations in Islam into the dustbin because it doesn't go well with our senses. Problem. When people are not educated in Islam, they turn up and then turn the yardstick for measuring Islam is their intellect. And your intellect has a limitation. So there's nothing like free thinking in Islam. You think within the confines of the Sharia. And you cannot satisfy people at all. At all, you cannot satisfy people. No. Someone will say the Almighty Allah discriminated against women in inheritance. Someone will say the hijab, the Almighty Allah, when he says you should wear hijab, it is oppressing women. And they would have their own thinking. Sheikh, I argue with them and they feel very discriminating. I think it's one of the reasons why Jeff Tonko said what he said. Let me tell you, if you really understand Islam, wallahi, you wouldn't make such statements at all. If you really, really understand Islam, you didn't make such statements at all. So I don't blame them. Him personally, I don't blame him. Even though I descended heavily on him, but I don't blame him. The reason why I did my videos was to clear those misconceptions. But then, him, I don't blame him at all. Because anybody, any Muslim who will open his mouth and say the Islamic way of sharing inheritance discriminates against women is totally ignorant about the Islamic way of sharing estates. And my video on that will give you further on that. Anybody who makes that statement has just shot himself in the foot concerning Islamic knowledge. So, fine, you can argue. But I will save my energy in rather educating. So sometimes after videos, I receive messages in my inbox. Some of them are controversial, some of them are questioning, some of them are challenging. The ones I feel there's a need to respond to, I respond. The ones I feel there's no need to respond to, I don't even mention it yet at all. I don't even reply the person. I do it a couple of times and then the person sent me a message that he's been sending me messages and I'm not responding. Doesn't mean I'm arrogant. I said, no. I'm not arrogant. You are saying something out of context. And I've explained to you, you are not agreeing to what the Quran and the Sunnah says. You want me to continue disturbing myself, to be pouring water on stone that I'm hoping that a seed will germinate out of the stone. No, I won't do that. So it's not being arrogant. It's just that I don't waste my energy on unnecessary arguments. I'm not saying you are doing unnecessary argument with them. Continue with them. Maybe in your explanation, the Almighty Allah might guide them. But then, my energy for argument, no, at all. Someone sent me a video, I think yesterday or this morning, saying that someone has made a statement that he wanted me to reply. I said, no, I don't have time for that. I said, there are three people that the Almighty Allah will not punish on the day of Qiyamah. The young boy, if he dies before growing old, and then the guy who is mentally unstable, and then the guy who is sleeping in his sleep and then he does something evil, Almighty Allah will not question you for that. So there are some people who are roaming about, who are mentally unstable. The Almighty Allah will not question them. You feel that they are sound, correct, but they are not sound, because some of the utterances that is coming out of some people's mouth is very, very damning. Seriously. Okay, thank you very much for watching us and listening to us. Another program that I must prepare for, inshallah. So we'll meet tomorrow. We'll look at the flexibility of the Sharia. It's flexibility of the Sharia. That's what we're going to look at tomorrow. Is the Sharia interested in punishing people? Is the Sharia difficult? That's what we're going to look at tomorrow. Is the Sharia difficult? Is the Sharia just about killing people, beating people, tearing people's backs? Is the Sharia about oppressing women, discriminating against them? Look at that tomorrow, inshallah. God willing. Thank you very much for being with us. May Almighty Allah bless us all, safeguard you, stay safe, be blessed. Jazakumullah khairan, barakallahu fikum, assalamu alaikum.